Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to Queens Public Library's Transforming Jamaica Bay's Marshlands. I'm Lynn from the Children's Library Discovery Center and Hunters Point Environmental Education Center. A little bit of library news before we get started today. Queens Public Library continues to celebrate our 125th anniversary. Don't forget to browse our book list and share your Queens Public Library story. For more information, visit qpl125.org. And begin 2022 with a library card. Get access to all of our materials, including books, ebooks, e-magazines, music, movies, and more. Our digital media options, which includes all of those digital resources, are available from anywhere with an internet connection. Try Hoopla, our new streaming service connecting you to movies, TV shows, and comics. And last weekend, we were celebrating Martin Luther King Day, and those programs will still be on our YouTube channel. Visit queenslibrary.org to learn more and explore all of these opportunities. Today's program is one of many for the Hunters Point Environmental Education Center. We have a program almost every Saturday at 2 p.m., plus programs on Tuesday and Thursday afternoons for children and teens and tweens. We hope to see you next Saturday, January 29th at 2 p.m. for Building Wild Patches. Check the comments. We'll be adding links to these events so you can set a reminder. And these programs are made possible by the Newtown Creek Environmental Education Environmental Benefit Fund, administered by City Parks Foundation and funded by the New York State Department of Environmental Conservation. If you have questions for our speaker, please write those in the chat. We'll have a question and answer session at the end of his presentation. And without further ado, we are so pleased to have Alex Zablocki with us today. Alex is Executive Director of the Jamaica Bay-Rockaway Parks Conservancy to discuss the history of Jamaica Bay's marshlands and their transformation over the last 100 years from loss to renewal. So it's all yours, Alex.
Lynn, thanks so much. Thank you to the Queens Library for hosting today and for having me. And of course, to the Hunters Point Environmental Education Center. It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you everyone for joining us today on a cold day. I'm coming live from Rockaway Park, Queens, just outside of Rockaway Beach on the Jamaica Bay shoreline. And it's fitting as we talk about transforming Jamaica Bay's marshlands. And I use this photo here on the right of a snowy owl. This was posted on social media and shared with us. And the reason why I'm posting or sharing this with you today is because in the comments on social media, someone said, if we build it, they will come. And what they were talking about is wildlife coming back to areas that were restored. The snowy owl is sitting on what's called goose fencing at the wildlife refuge. And it's at our recently completed Living Shoreline project and speaks to how these projects can attract wildlife and why we do the work that we do. As Lynn said, I'm the executive director of the Jamaica Bay Rockaway Parks Conservancy. And we're a public-private partnership founded in 2013, based right here in Queens, dedicated to improving over 10,000 acres of public parkland throughout Jamaica Bay and the Rockaway Peninsula. We do that in partnership with New York City Parks, the National Park Service, and New York State Parks. We support parkland over a 31 square mile area in both Brooklyn and Queens. We have some of the most beautiful parks in New York City. You may know of some of them, like Rockaway Beach, the Jamaica Bay Wildlife Refuge, Floyd Bennett Field, or Jacob Riis Park, Fort Tilden, and many more. If you haven't been to our parks, please come out and enjoy these public lands and open spaces. We have something for everyone during all seasons of the year. Now, you may be familiar with the area, but I just want to orientate yourself on what we'll be talking about today. We're talking about Jamaica Bay. It's a saltwater urban estuary right here in the heart of New York City, both in the boroughs of Brooklyn and Queens, just outside of JFK International Airport, and of course, along the Rockaway Peninsula in the Atlantic Ocean, and is bordered by the Belt Parkway, which does go through both Brooklyn and Queens. Over 800,000 residents live around Jamaica Bay. And this is an important place for not only wildlife, but for many residents in our city that not only play here in our parks, but also live, work, and raise their families. And today we're going to be talking about marshlands, and in particular, the loss of marsh in Jamaica Bay and also their renewal over the last 100 years. And I wanted to use this map from the New York City Wetlands Policy Paper in 2009 that I think shows this issue in great detail and what we're facing here in New York City. I want to focus particularly on the purple areas, historic tidal wetlands lost over the last 100 years. Look at all of the wetlands around the estuary of New York City that currently no longer exist. They've either been filled in by development or lost to things like sea level rise and pollution. As we zoom in closer to Jamaica Bay here in Queens, the wetlands used to extend further inland around South Ozone Park and Ozone Park, Howard Beach, Broad Channel areas of Far Rockaway, and along the Brooklyn waterfront in Canarsie, East New York, Bergen Beach, and Marine Park. Through development, Floyd Bennett Field in this area was filled in, connecting Barron Island to the mainland of Brooklyn, and areas of Breezy Point were filled in, as long as the sandy peninsula of Rockaway, creating, of course, all of the communities found along the Rockaway Peninsula. And Broad Channel, as well as the communities of Howard Beach, were also filled in over the past 100 years for development and also for things like roadways. And of course, the areas of JFK Airport. In the 1920s in Jamaica Bay, there was this grand vision of making Jamaica Bay an industrial hub for New York City, a place that would be dredged out and built out over time to support commerce. Thankfully, this plan never took place, though many areas along Jamaica Bay shoreline were filled in and again lost to things like JFK International Airport, Floyd Bennett Field is New York City's first municipal airport, and again, those other residential developments that I mentioned. Yet Jamaica Bay is still home to some beautiful salt marshes, some of the most important in our region. On the left is a salt marsh just outside of Sunset Cove at Broad Channel, and the upper right is a salt marsh at Garrison Creek at Marine Park. On the bottom right is a salt marsh outside of DuBose Point Wildlife Sanctuary in the Arvern community of Queens. And here are some more photos of beautiful salt marshes just outside of Shirley Chisholm State Park in Brooklyn, areas of Thursby Basin outside of Edgemere and Arvern in Queens, and then a photo on the bottom right that we took during one of our kayaking tours outside of what's called Blackwall Marsh, one of the marsh islands we'll talk about in a moment, in Jamaica Bay. But you may ask yourself, well, why are marshes so important? There's so much value for marshes, not only within our city and state, but around the globe. And I won't talk about all of the reasons why they're important, but just a few. First off, marshes are our first line of defense against extreme weather. They help attenuate wave action and absorb energy during extreme weather events. So communities that live around the shoreline that are surrounded by marshes are better protected when there is a healthy marsh. Marshes also act as sponges. They help collect pollutants. They take nutrients out of the water. So they're cleaning the water, they're cleaning the air, they're also providing habitat. And marshes have many other important features to them. And that's why around the world, there's a global movement right now to protect our marshes. So on February 2nd is World Wetlands Day. And this is a day that is recognized by the United Nations. And this infographic was just released showing that 35% of our global wetlands were lost over the last 55 years, and 85% of our wetlands around the world were lost since the 1700s. And what this means for our planet is a decline in biodiversity, increased carbon and methane emissions. We're losing our natural filtration systems in many cities. And we're also losing valuable habitat for wildlife around the world. And this is not just about salt marshes that we'll talk about today, but it includes mangroves and coral reefs and our floodplains, the swamps that are found in the Everglades, different estuaries around the world that are being threatened the same way. So I'm going to play a portion of this video right now that's on our YouTube channel. We produced this in partnership with the National Park Service last year, and it speaks to the issues of marshland loss in Jamaica Bay and also their renewal. And we'll share the link to this YouTube video at the end of the presentation.
A It's quiet. The sun is shining on your face. The wind is blowing. You can hear birds calling to one another back and forth. You're seeing species of tern and they're hunting. You can literally see the fish in their mouth. You're seeing larvae of like bee insects that are bugging you. I don't think that a lot of kids know this place is here. I've lived in Queens my whole life. This place is literally 30 minutes from my home. I didn't learn about it until I was a teenager. My name is Nakia Wilson and I do wildlife research here at Jamaica Bay Wildlife Refuge. Salt marshes are super important. They're nurseries, they're habitat, they're food. They filter our water. Salt marshes are actually as productive as tropical rainforests.
These islands are the lifeblood of Jamaica Bay. Unfortunately, we lost 70% of the marshes over the last 100 years. My name is Don Reapy. I'm the Jamaica Bay Guardian for the American Littoral Society.
Don Reapy. Oh, we love Don. He has such a heart and a passion for this place.
I met Nakia here. We were doing a study of the diamondback pelicans in the bay. I remember as a young boy growing up in Queens and seeing all the bird life and horseshoe crab and fishing. And so I began to, you know, really value and love the bay. So when I started seeing more of these places getting filled in and bulkheaded, dredged, abused by marine debris, I decided I need to do something about it.
At some point, it was so bad that we were losing about 40 acres of marsh island per year. That's 40 acres less of a habitat, of a home, of food.
If we don't protect the marshes, we lose all the marine life, the birds and other animals. But also, we're going to put New York City in a more dangerous place when we have any kind of nor'easters or hurricanes.
Salt marshes, they're like our frontline defenses. They act like sponges and they soak up extra water. If they weren't there, New York City would probably be underwater. See how it gets during hurricanes.
It's our nature, it's so nice. Nature is not nice.
Here in New York tonight, there is already a state of emergency.
Hurricane Sandy crashing on shore.
Oh my God, it's washing everything away!
What do you think of that hurricane?
I think it was kind of really dangerous.
Is this the future of New York now?
And our world is changing. Sea level is rising.
And we're going to do it.
Tell us a little bit about what's happening to restore the habitat of Jamaica Bay.
This has been going on for the past few years, especially post-Superstorm Sandy. There's been a big push to restore these islands and marsh areas.
Their efforts may make the area more storm-resistant and also keep local wildlife thriving.
Being out here, be able to breathe, do something nice for the environment, it's a great experience.
Sowing the seeds for a brighter, more resilient New York City.
They've been replanting the marsh islands.
They bring in sand, put it on top of the eroded marshes and then plant it, and it seems to be working well.
Yeah, it's been so successful. It's so encouraging to me to know, like, we've done wrong, we saw wrong, and we're fixing it.
Yeah, I like what's happened, but I don't think the bay is saved yet. We still have a ways to go, not only here, but as a nation. I'm hopeful because worldwide, we see young people getting more and more involved. You hope that of all the kids that you bring, you set a spark there. This is their future.
I always thought that I had to choose between working in New York and working outdoors in nature, never realizing that Jamaica Bay was here, the Marsh Islands are here. If kids came here, they could actually learn about things that they only see on TV. Jamaica Bay is for all of us to experience, enjoy. It's protected, it's ours, and it's here.
So as you saw in that video, Jamaica Bay is a special place, and it's right here in your borough of Queens. But as was mentioned in the video, it's constantly being threatened by sea level rise, climate change, and extreme weather. Here's a photo of the boardwalk at Rockaway Beach that was destroyed during Superstorm Sandy. Superstorm Sandy had disastrous effects on communities around Jamaica Bay, like Broad Channel, Howard Beach and others, and as well as the Rockaway Peninsula, due to this major storm event that we'll talk a little bit more about in a moment. The Cultural Landscapes Landslide 2019 report noted that Gateway National Recreation Area and the Jamaica Bay unit in particular was 1 out of 10 public lands across the country most at threat or jeopardy from climate change and being lost to the issues around climate change and sea level rise. And the Army Corps of Engineers has estimated that 220 acres of salt marshes were lost in Jamaica Bay from 1994 to 1999, and 1,400 acres of these wonderful and beautiful salt marshes were lost in Jamaica Bay since the 1920s. Nikita spoke a little bit about this in the video. Army Corps of Engineers has said that if left alone, the marshes could vanish in Jamaica Bay by the year 2025, destroying wildlife habitat and threatening the bay's shorelines. Now, the community realized this very early on. People like Dan Mundy Sr. and Dan Mundy Jr. of the Jamaica Bay Eco-Watchers, Don Reapy, our Jamaica Bay Guardian that was in the video, and the Army Corps of Engineers listened. Government stakeholders took notice to the loss of Jamaica Bay's wonderful marsh islands. This is a map or rendering they put together many years ago around salt marsh loss since 1951 in the bay. You can see these red areas showing all of the salt marsh loss due to pollution, climate change, and sea level rise. At Elders Point East, the federal government funded a major restoration project. Some of this was mentioned in the video. 2006, Elders East took shape, restoring 40 acres of Marsh Island in Jamaica Bay. At Elders West, part of the Elders East, that was also restored in 2009, another 40 acres. And then thanks to community support and the work of volunteers, areas of Yellow Bar, Blackwall Marsh, and Rulers Bar were also restored. Collectively, over 60 acres of Marsh Island planted out and restored by volunteers. Thanks to the efforts of not only the federal government and state and city elected officials and stakeholders, but also of community groups. And I want to mention the Jamaica Bay Eco-Watchers. They're a group that was formed out in Broad Channel, again, led by Dan Mundy Sr. and Dan Mundy Jr. with a lot of support from environmental organizations and local stakeholders, as well as the American Literal Society, that has been doing work around advocacy and restoration in Jamaica Bay for decades. And due to their efforts, I mentioned some of the projects that were already completed by the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, but this work continues. Just a few years ago, we brought volunteers out to Blackwall and Rulers Bar to continue restoring these marsh islands with grasses, to continue the effort of restoring these spaces that were lost due to climate change and, of course, pollution. And just in 2019, volunteers helped restore 74,000 native grasses at Sunset Cove, a New York City park that was restored by the city of New York, a former dumping site and defunct marina. Nearly 10 acres of restored marsh island or marshland habitat right here on the Jamaica Bay shoreline. Great views of sunsets in Queens. And as you can see, the city skyline of Manhattan, not too far in the distance, right here in the community of Broad Channel. And what I want to focus on is the Jamaica Bay Wildlife Refuge. This is your national park, and the Wildlife Refuge is the only accessible refuge across the country that is accessible by New York City subway. You could take the A train to Broad Channel and walk right over to the Jamaica Bay Wildlife Refuge. And the refuge is so important because it's on the Atlantic Flyway. Over 300 different species of birds can be found in Jamaica Bay annually. Millions of birds fly into Jamaica Bay and use it as a big gas station. As they fly north and south to feed, they nest here. And in the wildlife refuge, there are two man-made freshwater ponds, East Pond and West Pond. These freshwater ponds attract these migrating birds, and along the mudflats they feed. And as they refuel or nest here, they're able to get that energy to continue on to their final destinations. And it's important that we support the habitat in Jamaica Bay for this wildlife, but also because we depend on these places to act as our lung and our heart of our city to keep ourselves healthy and well and protect communities around it from extreme weather. This again is another map put together by the National Park Service showing something similar that the Army Corps of Engineers showed around salt marsh loss in the wildlife refuge since the 1950s. Now, what did we see happen at the wildlife refuge? Well, at that freshwater pond at West Pond, at the wildlife refuge, over 150,000 people annually visit this trail. It's about 1.7 miles in total distance. And during Superstorm Sandy in 2012, the storm breached this trail and ultimately took out the berm, and the freshwater pond emptied out into Jamaica Bay, and it was inundated with salt water. It was lost. And the Park Service, working with community stakeholders, decided that they would repair the breach area, make the trail whole, and ultimately restore this freshwater pond within the saltwater estuary. And the trail was restored in 2017 for visitors to once again enjoy. But what we saw was a very alarming and great deal of erosion along the Jamaica Bay shoreline that's shown here. So you could see some really healthy fragmented low marsh made up of what's called Spartina alterna flora, a marsh grass that's commonly found throughout Jamaica Bay. It's native. And we've seen acres of shoreline lost in this particular area over the last 30 and 40 years. And during nor'easters and other extreme weather events, the water was coming back up to this breach area and back up to the trail. So starting in 2019, our conservancy worked in partnership with the National Park Service and community stakeholders to design a restoration project outside of West Pond along the shoreline at the Jamaica Bay Wildlife Refuge that ultimately became a living shoreline project where we were looking to create 9 new acres of habitat along a 2,400 linear foot span of the shoreline from an area called Terrapin Point out to that breach area at West Pond, creating acres of new habitat, but then also putting in nature-based systems, all green infrastructure to help protect the shoreline, stabilize it, and hope that it will stay here for many generations and many years to come. In 2001, we completed design and we ultimately got the project permitted and funded, and the conservancy started building out this project in May of last year. As I mentioned, it's a living shoreline in a very dynamic environment. So it's meant to change and adapt over time. And like those larger Army Corps projects that I spoke about at Elders East and Elders West, here we're restoring shoreline habitat that's also marshlands. And it's about 9 acres, again, of new habitat with 14 total acres restored. And the way that we're helping stabilize the shoreline is we're using oyster shell bags to attenuate wave action and break down wave energy, which I'll get to in a moment. Along the filled in area of the shoreline, we've installed these things called core logs to further stabilize or hold in place the sand that we ultimately placed through the project. And then the entire area was planted out with native plants. Again, we started the project in May of last year and ultimately completed the project in November, bringing in over 51,000 cubic yards of clean sand to build out 9 new acres of habitat at the refuge. We worked with the Billion Oyster Project to fill 5,000 biodegradable bags filled with shell to create these breakwater systems. This was done by volunteers on Governor's Island, and a series of breakwaters along the entire edge of construction will help again attenuate waves and further stabilize that shoreline. This is what core logs look like. They're used commonly in projects. You might have seen them used out in Elders East if you're familiar with these types of projects and other types of shoreline restoration projects. They're meant to degrade over time and become a part of the shoreline. And our goal here is to help stabilize the shoreline using core logs to keep that sand in place. And as the shoreline changes, we're hoping that the shoreline will build up behind these core logs and breakwater structures. And in the area most susceptible to erosion and activity around waves and the prevailing winds that come onto the site, we've used recycled Christmas trees from the residents of Queens to further help stabilize and secure the shoreline in the area most vulnerable to erosion. And then finally, once the project was fully completed and graded out, and we created 9 new acres of habitat, it was planted with 200,000 native plants and shrubs, and we even engaged volunteers in this effort, continuing on the other efforts that were started by the Jamaica Bay Eco Watchers and American Littoral Society to engage stewards from the community in restoration work around our marsh islands. And here are some aerial images of what the project site looked like during construction. And then ultimately, once it was completed, these photos were provided by the New York City Department of Environmental Protection, which is a partner on the project. And as you can see here, we took back acres of land just around West Pond and the Jamaica Bay Wildlife Refuge. We cut the ribbon in November and the trail is now open. So I invite all of you to come out to the refuge. There's a nice visitor center. There's bathrooms on site. Again, accessible by the A train. There's a parking lot if you drive. You can also get there by bus or by bike along the Jamaica Bay Greenway. You can enjoy the trail. We'll be putting up signage for the project shortly. And as you can see behind them, that goose fencing or geese fencing is meant to dissuade birds from coming in and eating our grasses. And that's where that snowy owl was photographed a few weeks ago. I want to end with how you can get involved. So we'll have some planting projects later in the season, but coming up on February 6th, in honor of World Wetlands Day, we'll be hosting two cleanups, one in Queens and one in Brooklyn. One might be more accessible and more convenient for you to get to. The first is at Plum Beach at 8:30 a.m. Plum Beach Marshland. This is just outside of Jamaica Bay at the Rockaway Inlet. It's part of the National Park Service, Gateway National Recreation Area. And there we're going to go into the marshes and clean out debris that's harmful to our habitat out at Plum Beach. And then at Breezy Point, we'll be working with the New York City Plover Project and the National Park Service to clean up Breezy Point Tip, also part of Gateway National Recreation Area. And this is an important place for migrating birds and piping plover habitat. I want to thank you all again for joining us today, and I will certainly take any questions. Lynn, I can't hear you.
Sorry, I was blocking some of my noisy Queens neighborhood a few minutes ago. And now I have an annoying sun on me. Thank you so much, Alex. That was really so interesting. And I am really pleased to learn more about Jamaica Bay. I've been there by bus, subway, and bicycle. And I encourage everybody to get out there if they can. It's really a beautiful part of the city. And one of the things I wanted to ask you about, before I get my question in here, I want to remind people, if you have questions for Alex, please just type those into the chat. He is very knowledgeable. And so I have questions for you. One of the things that you've talked about how important marshlands are, and the sun is chasing me. And one of the things I was thinking about, we've been hearing about supply chains and supply chain problems so much lately. In a sense, those marshlands are supply chains for our environment, and particularly as you were talking about those migrating birds. As if we lose more marshland, it hurts those migrators and all other kinds of species within that system. But so we are situated on the western edge of Queens by the East River, which I think looks much different now than it did a couple of hundred years ago. And would there have been more marsh similar to Jamaica Bay in along the edges of Western Queens?
Oh, Lynn, absolutely. We are a city of islands, and our islands all were dotted with salt marshes around its edges, which through residential development, building out highways, filling in areas for industrial development along our waterfront, those areas were bulkheaded and those marshes were lost. There are efforts, as you know, in the area that you do work in, to restore those marshes. And in particular, not only bring back healthy marsh habitat using those grasses, as I mentioned, like Spartina, alternate flora, and other types of native species, but also looking at aquaculture, things like rib mussels or oysters. The Billion Oyster Project is doing quite a bit of work around restoring shellfish. We were once the oyster capital of the world. The largest oyster reefs found anywhere else on Earth. And here we lost them all due to over-harvesting and pollution. So you would have seen that probably in that area, definitely marshes. And that's true for most areas along our shorelines from Staten Island all the way up to the Bronx that have been lost to development. And I think that earlier map that I showed of Jamaica Bay is just so jarring. In fact, how far those tidal wetlands once came inland and have now all been filled for miles of shoreline with residential development. Those same communities were most impacted by Superstorm Sandy. So it just shows you how Mother Nature can always win and try to take back what was once lost.
One of the things that I was just shocked by the image you showed early on of that plan for just fully developing that area with residential areas and industrial areas, and just, oh my gosh, what would have happened during Sandy, if not earlier storms to all of that? Wow, devastation.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, look at what we have now, these beautiful marsh islands and open spaces throughout Jamaica Bay. Sometimes you don't even know you're in New York City. And if that plan ever came to fruition, this would have created an industrial hub within Jamaica Bay. It wouldn't have been the same place. And thankfully, those plans never came to fruition. Yet there was fill and development. You know, I didn't get into detail on landfills, but Jamaica Bay is home to many landfills. Shirley Chisholm State Park in Brooklyn is the former Pen and Fountain landfill. Edgemere Park, outside of Rockaway Community Park in the Arverne community of Queens, is a landfill. So Jamaica Bay has a history of being filled in, being used as a dumping ground. And thankfully, due to the local residents and efforts, we're turning back the tide, literally.
Well, along that line, one of our viewers, Sas Anduli, is asking, are you aware there is an Amazon warehouse build or I guess under construction in Idlewild Park off Rockaway Boulevard?
Yeah, you know, Idlewild Park is in an interesting place. It is within our catchment area, and we are aware of the restoration work that's going on there. So we have some good news. Idlewild Park has been a focus of New York City parks for the last few years, especially after Superstorm Sandy, thanks to the local efforts of community residents and advocates to try to restore a lot of the areas around Idlewild Park, an area that, or areas, communities around it that have suffered the effects of climate change and sea level rise. They know it well, and the effects of JFK Airport. And I think that speaks to building of warehouses, whether it be for Amazon or to support what's going on at JFK Airport in terms of redevelopment and having that be an economic hub in New York City. We see there to be opportunity around engaging some of the players at JFK Airport and developers to try to help restore marshes that were lost and also try to preserve what is left. So when it comes to building out new warehouses or looking at more industrial development around the airport or redevelopment of the airport, the Conservancy has been at the forefront of engaging agency partners that are responsible for permitting these projects and also redeveloping these areas to make sure that they are investing in our natural areas and protecting our environment. And ultimately what that means is that those investments will pay dividends for the residents that live around these wonderful natural areas. So if you are a resident of Queens, maybe you live out in Springfield Gardens or Laurelton, go out to Idlewild Park and enjoy the trails there and look at the open space. It's a unique part of Queens that often people don't visit. And you'll see all of this these wonderful natural areas just outside the airport. One other note around what's going on in Idlewild, we fund in partnership with the Natural Areas Conservancy, CUNY research interns, so City University of New York research interns that come out every year. Will be in our seventh year this year, and they do work around terrapin research. You saw the diamondback terrapins in the video earlier. So there's a lot of nesting sites back there as well. So birds are not only the only species dependent upon some of these wonderful salt marshes that we have here, but so are things like the diamondback terrapins and horseshoe crabs.
Oh, horseshoe crabs. That some years ago, probably about 4 years ago, kind of at the last minute found out about citizen science or community science evening to help the, at least in part, the Audubon Society do a survey of the horseshoe crabs that were coming in to nest. It was in late spring. It was pretty chilly, and yet we were out splashing around in the water, and it was so much fun. We were tagging them. And I wonder if there are more opportunities like that. I also know of a turtle study. I'm on their calendar for activities, but you know, it's a long ways from where I live. But a lot of people are becoming more and more aware, alarmed about climate change, and are, you know, feel like, what can I do as an individual? I think thinking about taking part in things like that, cleanups, et cetera, that is really helping kind of hedge our bets against climate change. And are there some more projects like that that you're aware of that maybe we could bring to light?
Sure. Well, first, let's talk about the horseshoe crab. The oldest inhabitant of Jamaica Bay, they've been here for over 100 million years, right? So they've outlived all of us. They're prehistoric in nature, and they're really important to the ecosystem. And we're losing horseshoe crabs at an alarming rate for various reasons. I'll talk about two of them and then their importance and why we really need to protect horseshoe crabs and study them more, and then how people can get involved. So first off, horseshoe crabs are taken by people who fish, and they're used as bait. And this has to stop. It's an issue that places like Jamaica Bay, other areas of New York City, Chesapeake Bay face. There's laws around this to protect horseshoe crabs. But as they're used for bait and over-harvested, then people have a misunderstanding about horseshoe crabs. They're afraid of them. We're losing horseshoe crabs due to this one issue alone. Secondly, as we build out our shorelines in bulkhead, sandy shorelines, or we're losing them to climate change, horseshoe crabs depend on that sandy shoreline to nest. And that's where they lay their eggs during the nesting period. So Lynn, when you went out there to do that monitoring, probably at night, I would say, if you could do it during the day, you probably went at night. You're doing that to see if how many horseshoe crabs are out there, how they look, and then also you might be tagging them or following the tags. You may see a horseshoe crab with a white tag on it. Put that number online and they'll tag where it's been. We're monitoring how well they're doing in Jamaica Bay in particular, because we've lost so much habitat, and we want to make sure that the species has a place to still thrive and lay their eggs. And the eggs are important not only for just the species themselves to continue, but there's birds that depend on those eggs as they migrate north and south to feed off of. So the red knot in particular, which is an endangered bird, lands here in Jamaica Bay on the Atlantic Flyway and feed on those eggs. And they fuel up in order to fly north or south, wherever these migrating birds are going. And that's why it's important to also protect horseshoe crabs. And just a fun fact for your viewers, horseshoe crabs are also used in medical research. And this is a problem because there's companies harvesting horseshoe crabs for their blood. They have a blue blood, so it's special type of blood that can find bacteria, which is helpful to medical research, but there's a way to make a synthetic blood that could do the same. As actually the horseshoe crab was used in some COVID research, believe it or not. But this is also a problem because we're losing horseshoe crabs to medical research. So people can get involved through monitoring through New York City Audubon. Universities do this, the Science and Resilience Institute at Jamaica Bay, which is at CUNY. But we also co-host with New York City Audubon and the American Little Society a horseshoe crab festival. And you can come out and get up close and personal with horseshoe crabs out at Broad Channel, at American Ball Fields. You can see them, you can touch them, you can learn more about them, and you can embrace this species. The Terrapin Research Project has also been doing work in Jamaica Bay for over 25 years. They're based out of Hofstra, led by Dr. Russ Burke and his team. And they're often looking for citizen scientists and volunteers to look for terrapin nesting sites, particularly around the Jamaica Bay Wildlife Refuge. Unfortunately, raccoons and other animals within Jamaica Bay will dig up the eggs and eat them. So their researchers are not only trying to protect nesting sites, but also these terrapins depend on sandy shorelines. And we need to make sure that we protect their habitat so we can protect that species as well.
And as I recall about that Terrapin research project where, you know, they asked people to help them collect data, is that something you can do on your own time? It's not that you have to meet the group there at, you know, at a specific time, like 2 o'clock on Saturday afternoon. So if it's something you would be interested in taking part in, you can fit it into your schedule. So we have a great question from one of our viewers. Can you talk about oyster restoration in Jamaica Bay, please?
Sure. Well, you know, Jamaica Bay also used to be a place that was filled with oyster beds, ultimately that were farmed and would go to market in New York City and beyond. It's known that New York City is the place the oyster built. There's been books written on this. And as I said earlier, Lynn, this was really the oyster capital of the world. And the Billion Oyster Project, who is a partner of the Conservancy on many projects, has been at the forefront of this. The Billion Oyster Project does have three oyster restoration projects in Jamaica Bay. The first is a large oyster restoration project just off of JFK Airport at what's called Head of Bay. This was in partnership with the City of New York. And viewers may recall reading about this. The City of New York took recycled toilet bowls and put them in Jamaica Bay. And along with some oyster restoration techniques, we're looking to see if this could support oyster reef habitat and oyster restoration within the bay. The Billion Oyster Project also worked with Sebago Canoe Club in Brooklyn off of Patuxent Basin, which is one of the main tributaries leading into Jamaica Bay. And they installed a cage system, so gabion cages with oysters, or what's called spat on shell, to see how oyster restoration would do in this particular area tributary at Jamaica Bay. And it's actually doing really well. So they've been monitoring that for a few years. And then the newest project that we've been directly partnering with the Billion Oyster Project on and engaging citizen scientists in some of the monitoring work is right here in Queens. It's the first in Queens. It's a community oyster reef off of Bayswater Point State Park, and that's in Far Rockaway. It's just also outside of JFK Airport, and it's a 96-bag reef system that was installed during the pandemic. And what we're doing here is we're looking for oyster growth within this bag system over time. So it's been in place for about a year. And Lynn, we engage local schools and residents in monitoring this reef system with the Billion Oyster Project, and it's doing well from what we can tell. So we think there's a real opportunity for more oyster restoration in the bay. But it doesn't stop there. Rib mussels are also found throughout Jamaica Bay and along our shorelines. And I know there's a big push right now from the City of New York and through our partners at the Science and Resilience Institute at Jamaica Bay to look at also more rib mussel restoration pilots around the bay to bring in more filter feeders. So a lot of opportunity in Jamaica Bay around restoration is a great question.
So, and another question, are the wastewater treatment plant BNR projects showing results? And then I'm gonna add a question to that. What are BNR projects?
Yeah, so I can't say what BNR speaks to in particular, but I know the projects they're talking to. So there was an investment made by the City of New York under the Bloomberg administration after suit was brought by the Jamaica Bay Eco Watchers and local community members to retrofit sewage treatment plants around Jamaica Bay to limit discharge of sewage into the bay through these tributaries. And there's been nearly $1 billion of investment in these sewage treatment plants or wastewater treatment plants around the bay. And more investment is to come, with hundreds of millions of more to be invested over the next 2 years. And to answer this question, yes, we are seeing results. You may have seen in the news recently, Ruffle, the baby seal that was seen on one of our marsh islands in Jamaica Bay, the millions of bunker, which is also known as menhaden, that are being found in Jamaica Bay right now because the water quality has gotten, has just improved by leaps and bounds since these investments were made at the wastewater treatment plants in Queens and Brooklyn, so along the edge. So we are seeing real results from these projects and investment that is being made by the City of New York. We still have more work to do, And it has to coincide with green infrastructure projects. It has to coincide with restoration of marshes. It has to coincide with doing more things around our edges, bringing in more green infrastructure projects that will further enhance the water quality of Jamaica Bay. But I could say with certainty that the water quality of Jamaica Bay is probably the best it's been in generations. And to, you know, to prove that, just look at the wildlife that has now come back to Jamaica Bay and how clear the water is.
Well, if anyone else has any questions, if you can get those in the chat, we're going to be wrapping up here shortly. And talking about the menhaden, that's whale food, isn't it?
Oh, yeah. Well, the whales love menhaden. Seals love menhaden. It's a favorite food of bluefish and striped bass. It's in abundance in Jamaica Bay. In fact, it was in our video. So when that aerial shot, you saw a school of fish, that was a school of menhaden, especially last summer. It's just an explosion of these bait fish. So they start off as juvenile fish, Lynn, within Jamaica Bay and in the estuary. And as they become, people who fish call them butterfish when they're smaller, they start to grow bigger and then will eventually make their way out through the Rockaway Inlet and into Lower New York Harbor and the Atlantic Ocean. And yes, the whale love them as well. And we see whales and dolphins off of Rockaway Beach. There is a whale watching boat that goes out of Reese Landing, and there's been a whale spotted in Jamaica Bay. It's a great food source. Also something though, and I will note this, that is over-harvested. There's companies and firms that go out and net menhaden on a mass scale, millions of them at a time. What they do is they grind up menhaden and they use it to make fish oil pills and other stuff. And you know, this has to stop. But here in Jamaica Bay, they're protected. And they're not only protected in terms of by law, but also by this wonderful Jamaica Bay estuary. So they have a great place to feed, and that attracts the larger fish and wildlife that feeds off of them. I'll also note, I'm reminding myself, menhaden is a favorite food of osprey, a raptor found in Jamaica Bay. Osprey were decimated in Jamaica Bay in the early 90s. Their eggs could not hatch because of certain pesticides. And once that pesticide was banned, osprey made a huge comeback. Right now, there's over 30 or just about 30 nesting pairs of osprey that migrate here in late spring to have their young. And what are they feeding on? Menhaden. It's their favorite food.
Well, I want to say thank you again, Alex. This has just been fabulous. We're so pleased you could be with us today and share your extensive knowledge of the marshlands and all those connections that the marshlands have to wildlife and really to us, and how those are, we need to be protecting those to protect ourselves. And I would really encourage our viewers out there to please get out there and visit. It is just amazing that's here. That's a part of New York City. We really have it all here. And so we have one more really quick question. I think we have time for that. How can volunteers get involved? Any opportunities for families? Great question.
It is a good question. And it's a great question to end on as well. First off, as I mentioned, our parks offer something for everyone during all seasons. So you can go right there, right to our parks right now and enjoy the trails and all of the wildlife that you could see during winter. But of course, our parks come to life with millions of visitors over the summer on our beaches and in our bays. You can go kayaking, paddleboarding, surfing, biking. Shirley Chisholm State Park, if anyone hasn't visited, right near the Queens border, there's a free bike program that we help fund in partnership with Con Edison and Bloomberg Philanthropies, where you can take a bike out Thursday through Sunday, May to October, and enjoy 10 miles of car-free trails there, and so many other activities for families. But volunteers can get involved on February 6th at our cleanup that I mentioned at Breezy Point and also Plum Beach. But we're going to be releasing our late winter and spring calendar soon on our website, jbrpc.org. We're not the only one that hosts volunteer programs throughout the year. We work in partnership with the American Literal Society, New York City Audubon, Jamaica Bay Eco Watchers, and others that are all hosting programs throughout the year, including festivals and free events at the Jamaica Bay Wildlife Refuge. So visit our website, click on events and calendar, follow us on social media, at JBRPC, where we post all of our programs, and you can come out and join us at one of our free events. All of our events are free, by the way. We did not charge Lynn. So come out and enjoy all of those events for free.
Fabulous. Well, thank you again, Alex. And to everybody out there, I want to quickly recognize our funder, the Newtown Creek Environmental Benefit Fund, administered by City Parks Foundation and funded by the New York State Department of Environmental Conservation. Please like and share this video. And by the way, this will be available on our YouTube channel. And in addition, subscribe to our Queens Public Library channel to get updates on upcoming programs. And I'll note that, again, next Saturday, January 29th at 2 p.m., we have Building Wild Patches. So we hope to see you then. Thank you, everybody, and have a great weekend.